BLS, Boston Regional Office.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thanks for having me here. My name is Mark Maggi. I work for the Bureau of Labor Statistics at the Boston Regional Office. We're at the JFK Federal Building in downtown Boston. I've been with the Bureau about 7 years, and I just wanted to thank Dr. Fashira for providing me with this opportunity. Part of our mission is outreach and educating the public on the data that we have available. I had first met Dr. Fashira at a conference in D.C. a couple years ago. She and I crossed paths again in Boston this past spring, and that's where we set up this. So thanks to you, and thanks to you all for coming. Before we get started, Dr. Shiro asked that I provide you a little bit of background information on myself and my career at the Bureau. I think most of you are all econ majors, is that correct? Okay. Finance, similar? Okay. So you're probably familiar with Bureau data, at least. From 2001 to 2005, I attended St. Mary's College of Maryland. Started my academic career as a political science major, and as a poli-sci major, I had to take Econ 101, macro, micro, and thought that the econ stuff wasn't too bad, and I had room in my schedule to pick up a second major. So I added the economics major my sophomore year and graduated with dual degrees in political science and economics. Senior year of college, I didn't really know what I wanted to do. I had interned on Capitol Hill. I knew I didn't want to work in politics after that. I thought about going back to school. Didn't really have much direction. Spring of my senior year, the Bureau was at a career fair on campus. Went and talked to them. I was familiar with their data as an econ major. We used it a lot. Didn't really know what it took to work there, who the people that worked there were. Found out with 21 semester hours of credit, of econ credit, you could be an economist at the Bureau of Labor Statistics. They do have statisticians as well, the most common position is economist. So I applied for a position as an economist and started in 2005 in the National Office in Washington, D.C. I worked in the Occupational Employment Statistics Program for about 3.5 years in Washington. In 2009, my fiance at the time got transferred to a job in the Boston office. I transferred to the Boston Regional Office of the Bureau in April 2009 and have been with the Economic Analysis and Information Program for about 3.5 years. EA&I, as it's called, is tasked with sort of being the jack of all trades. I'm not an expert in any one Bureau program data product, but we have to know a little bit about everything. We answer phone calls from the media. It's us who you see quoted in the paper when they say a Labor Department official said. We answer questions from students doing research, or professors, things of that nature, and then we go out and give presentations like this. So, the topic for today's technical session, we're going to talk a little bit about ReJobs. This is the newest data product available from the BLS. Work started a couple years ago, and data was just produced, or published, I should say, this spring, and then again in June, with more data scheduled to come out on Friday. So we'll talk about a little bit of the history of our involvement with this. The definition we developed early on, we realized that there was no definition for what is a green job, so we start from scratch. Our data collection methodology, the survey results, as I said, we have two different sets of survey results we're going to talk about here, and then we'll quickly transition into some employment projections data, which might be of particular interest to college students and to yourself, and it's EP is employment projections is our most popular data product. People always want to know what's going to happen. We can't tell the future, but we can make an educated guess about it. All right, first let's talk about the BLS's Green Jobs Initiative. What were the goals of this when we started? We wanted to track the number of green jobs and how this number changes over time. We wanted to track some details on these jobs. What industries are they in? What occupations are people employed in that are green? And where are these jobs located? We wanted to track the pay of these green jobs. Does a worker doing one task in a green job make significantly more or less than a worker doing a similar task producing a non-green good or service? And then we also have some career information available on green jobs, which was the first Bureau data product available on this topic. So our first product was to define what is a green job. We were hoping someone might have done this for us, but it was not to be. The Bureau is a statistical agency. We're not a program agency, we're not a policy agency. Therefore, our definition needs to be objective, measurable, free of judgment calls. We can't make it sound like we're promoting green jobs or trying to inflate the number. This had to be, and all our methodology public, it's all on the website. People might not like how we collect the unemployment rate, or they might not like how we collect the CPI, but it's all out there, and you can replicate it yourself, and you're not gonna get any different results than we do. So that's, you know, impartiality is really our focus. So we knew, coming up with this definition, we had to be impartial. It also had to be measurable. We had to ask people questions that they were gonna be able to answer. When we put a survey in the field, if respondents can't answer or accurately answer our respond to our survey questions, then it's a moot point. These things happen. Data has to be collectible. And all our surveys are voluntary. So it has to be relatively easy to collect. as we're asking people to take time out of their workday to voluntarily complete a survey. Finally, it needed to be comparable to other data. That means it had to harmonize with standard classification systems. That's using the NAICS, the North American Industry Classification System, for industry classification purposes, and the SOC, the Standard Occupational Classification System, for occupational classification purposes. So in developing our definition, we did a lot of background work. As I said, we realized that there was no widely accepted definition of what a green job was. So we reviewed a wide range of studies, consulted with a variety of stakeholders, including federal agencies, industry associations, and state partners. We looked at international work, and were especially influenced by Statistics Canada, who did a similar survey, as well as Eurostat, who did an environmental survey. We participated in the Workforce Information Council's Green Jobs Study Group. They looked at definitions, existing surveys and studies, lessons learned, and action plans for the states. The common thread through the studies and discussions is that green jobs are jobs related to preserving or restoring the environment. Several categories of green activity are nearly universally cited: producing energy from renewable resources, improving energy efficiency, preventing and cleaning up pollution and greenhouse gases, and conserving natural resources. Here's a bit of a timeline of our effort. As I said, it took a little bit longer than we anticipated. In March of 2010, we published a proposed definition in the Federal Register and asked for comments. During the comment period, we received comments that ranged from, "Why the heck are you doing this? Stop wasting my taxpayer dollars," to, "Thank you for doing this. It's about time someone did." And then in between were a lot of thoughtful comments from industry and trade organizations that were probably more expert in the field than we were, and we were able to incorporate a lot of that stuff. On September 21st, 2010, we published a final definition in the Federal Register, along with a summary of and response to all the questions we received. So the BLS is going to use, or we are using, I should say, two approaches to measuring green jobs. Each of these approaches is going to require a different measurement strategy. First, the output approach. The output approach is similar in many ways to the usual way we tabulate employment by industry, since establishments are classified by industry on the basis of what they produce, that is, the good or service that they make. This is where NAICS comes into play, North American Industry Classification System. The output approach identifies establishments that produce green goods and services and counts the associated job. In the output approach, we're concerned with jobs related to producing a specific set of goods and services. We're not concerned with how the good is produced. For example, the easy examples are solar panels or wind turbines. Most people aren't going to argue that those are green goods. However, we're not concerned with the environmental impact of production. So we're really just concerned with the end product, the output. And that's the way we classify all industry employment. The output approach alone, however, wouldn't cover some activities that may be green, even though the good or service produced in and of itself isn't inherently green. So that's where process approach comes in. Process approach is different from our usual way of calculating employment, and there's no taxonomy of technologies and practices. The process approach identifies establishments that use environmentally friendly production processes or practices and counts the associated jobs. In the process approach, we are concerned with whether the business uses practical technologies that have a favorable impact on the environment, regardless of the good or service produced. Since we don't care about the good or service produced, the process approach can be relevant to any industry. So what is the BLS Green Jobs definition? Green jobs are either jobs and businesses that produce goods or provide services that benefit the environment or conserve natural resources. That's what we're going to focus on more today. Or jobs in which workers' duties involve making their establishments' production processes more environmentally friendly or use fewer natural resources. The first BLS Green Jobs product we're going to discuss, and one we'll spend a little bit more time on, is the Green Goods and Services Survey, the GGS. This calculates industry and state employment and is concerned with that output approach. For the GGS, we identified five categories of green goods and services: energy from renewable resources, or nuclear. Nuclear is a bit controversial, but there's no green goods produced, so it's green good. We can't make judgment calls. It fits the definition. Environmentalists might not like it, but we have to try and stay apart. Energy efficiency, pollution reduction and removal, greenhouse gas reduction, and recycling and reuse. Natural resources conservation, and environmental compliance, education and training, and public awareness. So moving from the definition to putting into practice, we needed to identify specific goods and services and the industries where they're produced. Our general approach is to designate as green only those goods or services that directly benefit the environment or preserve natural resources. The BLS does not designate as green the goods or services produced by industries that supply inputs to or distribute the outputs from green producing industries. So if Coca-Cola uses recycled cans, the green job is at the recycling point, not at Coca-Cola's point. So we identified 333 six-digit detailed makes industries. There's about 1,200 detailed industries total. So we're talking about a quarter of all industries we thought there might be green goods or services being produced there. There's about 2.2 million establishments in these industries out of a national total of about 9 million establishments. Here we have some examples of the industries that have potential green content. So this was our survey pool. So this is what we sent the surveys out to. Organic corn production or anything organic for that matter. Electric power production from wind, solar, biomass, hydroelectric, or nuclear. Manufacturing energy efficient products, hybrid batteries. Manufacturing Energy Star appliances, the federal standard level you've all probably seen in your computers or your refrigerators. Sewage treatment facilities and air construction. Construction using leadership in energy and environmental design. That's an industry standard, a construction industry standard we'll talk about later. The retrofitting of buildings for energy efficiency, aluminum smelting, recycling, urban mass transit, and then government development and enforcement of environmental regulations. So the BLS is committed to using well-established, well-recognized standards for consistency. This is, we had a term somewhere when we started this whole project. These standards provide an objective and measurable method to distinguish green goods and services from other similar goods or services that may not be green. Examples of such federal standards are Energy Star, it's a federal energy consumption standard for appliances and electronics. Well-established and widely recognized industry standards are also used to the extent that they're objective and measurable. If an industry is using it purely for marketing purposes, we're not going to use it, but if it's measurable and objective and widely accepted, we'll use it. That's where LEED came in, the green building rating system and construction system. So how have we gone about collecting this data? We surveyed a sample of establishments in those listed industries to find out whether the establishment does produce green goods or services. If they do produce green goods or services, what share of their revenue came from the production of those green goods and services? We're using share of revenue as a proxy for share of employment for a couple reasons. Statistics Canada tried a similar environmental survey and found conducting share of employment is difficult. We field tested our survey, but we found the same thing. And again, I stated earlier, is that the data needs to be collectible. If we're at an establishment for 4 hours trying to explain a definition to somebody, they're not going to be likely to participate, and we're not going to be likely to get the data we have. So an easy example, if you have a car manufacturing company, they produce two vehicles, a pickup truck and a hybrid. If we call them and say, what percentage of your workforce works on the hybrid? They might not know the answer. If we say, what percentage of your revenue comes from the hybrid? If they don't know that, they're probably not going to be in business, because every business has to know its revenue streams. So if they have 100 people working, and 70% of their revenue comes from the hybrid vehicle, we're going to say 70 people in that establishment out of 100 are a green job. Again, it's a proxy. We found it to be a pretty effective proxy, and it makes the data collectible. We're relying on our own field testing as well as work, as I said, done up in Bio Park up in Canada. So here's the schedule for the Green Goods and Services Survey. The first GGS release was published on March 22nd, and we'll get into those the survey results now. For additional detail, the full press release is available online. It's pretty easy to find. Our search bar is pretty good, or you can contact me directly. I'll give you my contact information. Just some background information on this data before we get started. The data published for the first GGS press release are based on 2010 annual average estimates. 2011 data will be out in January. This provided a count of the number of jobs in the economy that met the GGS definition of green employment. Again, this is based on the output approach for those industries producing green goods or services. Published estimates include percents and levels of GGS employment in major sectors of the economy. So what are GGS jobs? They can be any type of job. There's no skill level specifically required. There's no judgment calls made. The work of all employees at an establishment contributes to the output of that establishment. Therefore, all employees at an establishment count as green. An example would be a hospital. It's not just the surgeons and the doctors and the x-ray techs who count as healthcare jobs. People working in the cafeteria, people sleeping on the floor, everybody's work goes towards the output of healthcare services. So they're all falling to the healthcare industry. If we're looking at a wind turbine factory, it's not just the people working on the electronics of the wind turbines. Everyone at the establishment, their work goes towards the production of that wind turbine, so everyone at the establishment is counted as green. If you remember earlier, I stated the BLS GGS sample included 333 detailed industries. That's out of 1,193 total industries, about 1,200. We only surveyed the industry where we felt there'd be a chance of finding green employment. We knew there wasn't going to be green employment. It didn't make sense to spend the time and money sending the survey. this isn't to say that all 33 of the industries definitely had green employment, just that was our potential pool of where green employment might be. Total employment in the U.S., as measured by the QCW program, about 128 million in 2010. So before we started our survey, the GGS scope, those 33 industries, had about 25 million people employed. And so that was our potential was the whole universe of 128 million. We cast our net out about 25 million and pulled back about 3 million. So about 2.4% of national employment, 3,129,100 jobs as defined by the GGS. As I mentioned earlier, we collected employment figures using share of revenue as a proxy. We found no GGS revenue at 69% of establishments, some revenue, but less than 100 at 17% of establishments. Those 17% of establishments were responsible for 41% of green employment. So that's your automobile manufacturer that produces a pickup and a hybrid. They have split revenues. 100% of revenue, 14% of establishments producing 59% of green employment. So that's your wind turbine factory that only makes wind turbines. So what did the data say? On a national scope, 3,129,100 green jobs, as I said, in 2010, 2.4% of total employment. Almost 2.3 million of these jobs were in private industry, comprising about 2.1% of total private employment, and 860,300 jobs in government, 4% of total government employment. Represented in this chart, it's not blocked, okay, are the top industry sectors by number of green jobs, so manufacturing and construction were the top two. And we'll talk about these in a little bit more detail now. In the private sector and within manufacturing, there were nearly 500,000 green jobs, representing about 2% of manufacturing employment. While manufacturing is a broad industry sector, the industries we find the highest level of green jobs are where you expect them to be. Primary metal, which would include recycling, and iron and steel recycling. HVAC equipment, almost 41,000 jobs, which includes, that's heating, ventilation, air conditioning, which includes air purification, heating, cooling, things of that nature, and then transportation equipment. Construction was the second largest GGS sector by private employment. Green activities in construction include LEED certified construction projects, that industry standard we talked about earlier, the retrofitting of buildings for energy efficiency, and the construction of power plants using renewable or nuclear sources. And professional, scientific, and technical services was the third largest private sector with regard to GGS employment. Examples of services, so the first two things were goods. Example of services that meet the BLS definition, architectural engineering services, if they're designing green buildings or green construction projects, things of that nature. Environmental consulting services, research and development in the sciences related to the environment, and legal services related to environmental regulations. Here we have private sector employment in the electric power generation industry. The employment for wind, biomass, geothermal, and solar might appear to be small, but this is limited to those establishments that actually produce energy for sale or distribution. This is not a full solar or wind industry employment measure, because this doesn't include the manufacturing of wind turbines or solar panels. Parts of the solar panel, the solar industry, for example, would be found in other industries. Solar panel manufacturing would be in the industry titled semiconductors and related device manufacturing. So the solar panels are produced in one place, but they might be used for power generation at another place. Solar panel installation could be in construction. Within the public sector, there were 860,300 green jobs as defined by the BLS definition, about 4% of total public employment. Among the federal, state, and local categories, you see corresponding levels, the numbers, and shares of employment. Within local government, you'll find many transportation jobs meeting the BLS definition of green jobs. Urban mass transit is considered a green job. And you'll notice that public administration ranks high both at the state and federal level. That includes environmental agencies responsible for training, compliance, and implementation of environmental regulations. Here we have green goods and services as a percent of total state employment. I know it's kind of hard to see, but we'll talk about some of these states in a little bit more detail. Rhode Island was at 2.7% of state employment. Listed here are the five states with the highest percentage of GGS jobs. Right here in New England, Vermont was number one. DC, our 51st state, was number two. A lot of that is environmental regulation development, enforcement, compliance, things of that nature. I added this just for you guys. Hope you appreciate it. Rhode Island, total GGS employment, 8,000. 3,804 people. The largest sector was transportation and warehousing, followed by construction. So a little bit about this data. The press release from March 22nd was the Bureau's first release. It was simply a single observation. This was one snapshot in time. We didn't go back, we didn't project forward. It was just a single snapshot of the year 2010. 2011 data will be out in January. So this 2010 data is going to be our baseline for measuring all future trends from here on out. We're planning to issue quarterly updates. As I said, the next round of data will be released in January. 2010 data was released in March of 12. 2011 data will be released in January of 13. So we've cut the production schedule down by about 2 months, and we're getting a little bit better with this. The second BLS Green Jobs product is going to be conducted as part of the GGS survey. We're going to collect occupational staffing patterns and wages for people employed at those GGS establishments. So we know how many people work at the solar panel factory, what jobs are people in at that solar panel factory, and what do they make? This is the second product. And this data will actually be released on Friday. So I'm not privy to it. If I had it, I couldn't tell you anyway, but I'm going to have it, so even I don't know. We're going to collect employment and we'll collect employment and wages by occupation from the establishments that were in that GGS survey sample. The sample is going to overlap with our regular OES survey sample. OES is the program I originally started in, which calculates occupational employment and wages. So this is what OES does. OES is good at getting wage data. So we passed the GGS survey sample off to them and said, hey, while you're collecting your own wage data, can you get it for these establishments as well? And they're happy to do that. We're going to collect data on occupational data for all jobs in the establishment, not just those with particular skill sets or activities that some might consider green. Again, it's not just the photovoltaic engineers at the solar panel factory, it's everybody. We want to see, does an administrative assistant make more at a green factor than a non-green factor? So we expect to be able to look at, do staffing patterns differ based on whether the output is green or not. And once more, this data is coming out Friday. It'll be at the top of the page, bls.gov, you'll find it right there. So the next main, that's sort of a subset of that GGS. The other main effort that we're conducting is the GTP, the Green Technologies and Practices Survey. So if you remember from earlier, the BLS definition of a green job consists of two parts. Jobs in industries that produce green goods or services, and jobs in which workers' duties involve making their establishments operations more environmentally friendly or use fewer natural resources. The Green Technologies and Practices Survey, the GTP, is the BLS survey designed to collect data on jobs that may exist in any industry, not just the green industries collected by the GTS. So, for the Green Technologies and Practices Survey, what are these technologies and practices that someone might be doing in a conventional factory or establishment that we consider a green work activity? We've got six categories, and the category is a practice, a technology, or a method. Generating energy from renewable resources for use within the establishment. A firm that generates renewable energy primarily for sale is not included here because they are in the GGS. Their output is green. In the GTP, this practice is specifically for on-site use. So if you've ever been up to Boston, City Hall has a little wind turbine on top. There's a guy whose job it is to man that wind turbine and make sure the power comes back into the building. Even though City Hall is not a green establishment, that might be a green job at a non-green establishment. Improving energy efficiency within the establishment. Policies and procedures that make the establishment more energy efficient. The use of motion detecting lighting, thermostats set really high, so we're all in the classroom, things of that nature. Reducing greenhouse gas emissions resulting from operations. Policies and procedures such as employee telework arrangements or subsidies for people who use urban mass transit, things like encouraging bike transportation, a bike room, things of that nature. Reducing or eliminating the release of pollutants or toxic compounds resulting from operations. An example of this might be the installation and use of a smokestack scrubber. Not the production of the smokestack scrubber, that comes from the GGS. This is actual the use of a smokestack scrubber. Reducing or eliminating the creation of waste materials or wastewater resulting from operations. Here we're talking about redesigning an existing operation within the establishment to reduce waste or reuse it. An example might be Nike grind. Nike uses scrap shoe material to make carpet padding and to make running shoes. Conserving natural resources consumed during business operations. Here we need to be very sure that our respondents understand that we don't want them included using recycled inputs. The benefit to the environment occurs at the point in which the material is recycled, as we talked about earlier with the Coca-Cola example, and that point is captured in the GGS. We're not including the purchase and use of recycled inputs in the GTP because we've already captured that employment. Activity in this category would be a facility that captures and reuses rainwater, or a restaurant, for example, that might have a small garden out back that grows its own vegetables and herbs. So the purpose of the GTP is to identify green occupations within establishments and collect occupational wage data for those workers. GTP defines as green an occupation where more than 50% of an employee's time is spent. So we have this 50% cutoff. So if the guy who mans that wind turbine City Hall spends 20 minutes a week on it, he's not a named job yet. He does it. It's a 3-day-a-week job, he's doing 20. So if you spend your time, more than 50% of your time, researching, developing, maintaining, or using technologies or practices related to the six categories of green activities we just discussed, or the training of workers at establishments in these technologies or practices. So if wind turbine guy has an apprentice and he spends his time training that guy, that would count too. So if we put all the puzzle pieces together here for the GTP, we're going to sample all industries, because again, we're not concerned with the output of the GTP, other than private households. We're going to ask whether they have employees engaged in these activities. By engaging, we mean researching, developing, maintaining, using, or training employees in those six categories we talked about. Collect the total employment of workers spending more than 50% of their time engaged in those activities. And then we'll collect occupational employment and wage information for those workers. Development of the GTP was on a better track than the GTS. This is a little bit more nebulous collection concept. Industry employment is something we've been doing for 60 years. This technology practice stuff is something we're doing for the first time right now. Field testing began in the summer of 2010 with cognitive interviews and feasibility interviews conducted that fall. Panel testing of a survey form and production of a web collection instrument were in January of 2011, and work on the form and web instrument was completed that summer. Collection span from the fall of 2011 until the spring, and data was just released on June 29th. I'll just give you a brief overview of this GTP data, just so it kind of completes the puzzle with the GGS data. It gives you a good idea of the total green employment as calculated by the BLS. So let's briefly touch on some of that GTP data. 75% of business establishments report the use of at least one green technology or practice. That's the second bar right there. The two most frequently reported types of green technology practices were those that improve energy efficiency within the establishment, reported by 57% of establishments, and those that reduce the creation of waste materials as a result of operation, which is reported by about 55% of establishments. The least commonly used technology or practice was the generating of electricity, heat, or fuel from renewable resources, primarily for use at the establishment, reported by just 2% of establishments. So not a lot of establishments are powering themselves. Detailed occupations with the largest number of GTP jobs included janitors and cleaners with 56,700 jobs, heating, air conditioning, and refrigeration mechanics and installers with a little over 37,000 jobs, and general maintenance and repair workers with 26,000 jobs. Finally, I want to highlight some career information related to green jobs available from BLS, as this was our first data product available. This came out for our two surveys, actually. Since it came out before our two surveys, there wasn't BLS data for using this, so we used data from secondary sources. Secondary sources include trade organizations, other government agencies, academic research, our attendance at conferences and meetings. Now that we have BLS data, these will be updated with BLS data where it's appropriate. The first article on this topic, titled Careers in Wind Energy, was published online this September of 2010. And a short wind energy article is also included in the winter edition of the Occupational Outlook Quarterly, which is a quarterly hard copy publication produced by the Bureau that takes a look at specific occupations and industries on a quarterly basis. It's one of the last hard copy things we still publish. Other topics listed here, solar panels, green construction, electric vehicles, recycling, energy auditors, those are the people that come to your home and tell you, you know, where heat or air might be escaping from, and sustainability. That address is where you can find all of these articles. You can also email me, and I'd be glad to email you. So this discussion of green careers is going to allow us to kind of shift gears and talk about some occupational employment projections data and some industry employment projections data that Dr. Bashiro had asked me to touch on this morning. Since we have limited time here, and I want to leave some time for questions, especially about the green job stuff, I'll give you some quick background information, a brief overview on both industry and employment projections, and I can guide you in the right direction should you wish to dive deeper into this data. So the BLS produces a new set of projections every 2 years for a 10-year span. Our most recent set of projections are 2010 to 2020. 2012 to 2022 will be out next year. They cover over 700 detailed occupations and 300 detailed industries. The projections form the basis for data and outlook information in the Occupational Outlook Handbook, the OOH, with a new edition of the handbook released shortly after a new set of projections is published. The OOH is sort of our master career guide. I don't know if anyone's planning to come to the afternoon session. We're going to talk about the OOH in a lot more detail. It used to be this big reference book. You had to flip through it. It's kind of a pain in the butt. It's now a really interactive, user-friendly website with drop-down menus and search tools and things of that nature. So we're catching up to the 21st century, even though we're 12 years into it. A wide variety of people will use this employment projections data. These include career counselors and students, such as yourselves, making career choice decisions, mid-career job seekers, which I know some of you are as well, looking to switch occupations, state educational program planners reviewing curriculum. It doesn't make sense to devote educational funds and resources towards the training of employees and jobs that are going to not be in the economy in the future, and researchers interested in how the economy is changing, structural changes in the economy. So what industry changes do we expect to see over the next 8 years? Anybody have a guess on what industry we think might grow a lot?
IRS agents?
That would be government, which is actually on the other end of the spectrum. Healthcare, medical, yeah. Healthcare and social assistance, which is made up of private institutions, is the fastest growing industry in addition to being the largest in terms of projected employment gains. And talk to Dr. Academy, he said that nursing and medical school here is the largest major. Construction employment is projected to grow fast, but that's more a matter of where we are right now than anything else. 2020 employment is still projected to be below the peak 2006 employment, but we lost so much employment from 06 to 09, and even it's continued to drop, that we're not going to reach that 2006 peak, but it's got to come back a bit. Educational services, which is made up of private educational institutions, is the third fastest growing sector in terms of employment. We're talking percentage growth here, not absolute values, but number of jobs. It's ranked ninth in terms of the number of jobs added. State and local government includes public education and hospitals. See right there. Federal government is the sector projected to see the largest declines. And the reason for this is pretty obvious. Two things. The increased pressure to reduce the government budget deficit will be one of the major contributors. And a lot of this is just not backfilling positions from people that retired. A lot of my retiring coworkers were just picking up their work. We're not filling their jobs. And the big thing is the Postal Service. The Postal Service is expected to be responsible for almost half of the decrease in federal government employment. Widespread use of email, online bill pay, increased circulation of magazines, iPads. Consumers are moving away from services produced by the provided by the Postal Service industry. So let's take a look at some occupations data, occupational data related specifically. This slide shows the top 10 fastest growing detailed occupations. That is the largest projected percentage increase. We're talking percentage growth, and this is the median annual wage for these jobs as it stood in 2010. We're not projecting their wages. The increase in healthcare employment is reflected here with three of the top 10 in either the healthcare practitioner and technical occupations group, which is your doctors and nurses, those technical jobs, or healthcare support group. Four of the 10 are in construction and extraction occupations, which are projected to grow as the construction industry begins to recover. A lot of these is just filling jobs that were lost over the past 3-4 years. The two fastest growing occupations, personal care aides and home health aides, will be affected by demographic changes. That's the biggest thing. Both assist the elderly, convalescents, and persons with disabilities in the person's home or in a care facility. Home health aides provide health services such as administering medications, while personal care aides provide more general services such as cooking meals. And these are occupations, and I mentioned that we use the SOC, the Standard Occupational Classification System, for occupational detail. We have about 802 detailed occupations. So these occupational titles here you can find, and you can find their description online in that SOC manual, which is available. Although biomedical engineers and reinforcing iron and rebar workers are on the list, they're expected to add relatively few jobs, 9,700 and 9,300 respectively. Six of these occupations do make less than the national median. The national median is 33,840. So six of the fastest 10 projected to grow are on the lower end of the pay scale. This slide shows the 10 occupations expected to add the most jobs. Now we're talking absolute number of jobs in thousands. Many of the occupations listed on the table are very large and will also create many new jobs, but when it's so big, the growth rate might look small. 3% growth rate might not seem like a lot until you realize that there's millions of people doing this job. The expected growth in healthcare will drive the demand for registered nurses, which are projected to add the most new jobs. And home health aides, you see over 700,000 for both of those. Two office and administrative support occupations appear on this list as well, dental office clerks. Office clerk, common general, assistant general. And customer service representatives, primarily because they are large occupations and they're employed across all industries. Both had more than 2 million jobs in 2010. Only two of these occupations, home health aides and personal care aides, were also among the fastest growing. Seven of these occupations make less than the national median of 33,840. So again, some of the highest projected growth from the lower end of the pay scale. This slide shows 10 detail occupations projected to decline most rapidly, the largest projected percentage decrease. Shoe machine operators and tenders, hopefully none of you are studying to be one of those, projected to decline 53.4%. Occupational employment declines generally stem from changes in technology, such as automation, business practices, or declines in the industries where the occupation is concentrated. If your occupation, we talked about those administrative assistants, they're across all industries. So if you're in an industry that's contracting, well, you can find a job as an administrative assistant in another industry. If you're in a job that's just in one industry, and that industry is contracting, a lot less options. As I said, the occupation expected to decline the fastest is those shoe machine operators. However, this decline will only cause the loss of 1,700 jobs over the next 10 years. Five of these occupations are textile, apparel, and furnishing workers, all concentrated in the textile and apparel manufacturing industries, and a lot of that is just due to increased imports. It's a structural change in the economy. Three occupations related to the Postal Service make the list, as that agency faces cuts in cost cutting. Four occupations are also among the 10 occupations with the largest employment declines: Postal Service mail sorters, Postal Service clerks, sewing machine operators, switchboard operators. Even in occupations that aren't expected to see growth, though, there will be a need to replace workers. So even if it's not expected to grow, it doesn't mean there's no employment opportunities, just that we don't see them rapidly increasing as we do in other areas. This slide shows the 10 detail occupations projected to lose the most jobs from 2010 to 2020. Really shouldn't be too much of a surprise. Farmers, ranchers, and other agriculture managers, again, my numbers aren't shown there, but they're projected to lose 96,100 jobs, more than any other occupation. This is due to a couple factors. Technological improvements and consolidation continue to reduce the number of workers needed to produce the nation's food. We're not doing things by hand as much anymore. We see three occupations related to the Postal Service, and four of these were among the 10 fastest declining. Mail sorters, postal service clerks, sewing machine operators, and switchboard operators. Finally, I wanted to make you aware of some of the products available from the BLS Employment Projections Program. We have the Occupational Outlook Handbook, and this is what it used to look like in hard copy form, which is used, as I said, by counselors and students looking to make career decisions. The handbook includes not only job outlook information, so it takes some of this projections data, but also job description, education and training requirements to get into that field, projected earnings data. So it's really a comprehensive look at, if you know you want to be an economist, and come join me. You can see what training and certifications are required. What is this job going to look like in the future? So it really gives you, what can I be expected to make? So it gives you a good comprehensive overview of what are my prospects if I want to actually do this, and if I do want to do it, what do I need to do to get myself there, and what might I potentially make? This was previously published as a large hard copy reference book, but is now available online. The address listed here, bls.gov/OOH. The new OOH provides a very interactive user experience. I'm going to go over this in more detail this afternoon. If you're not going to be here this afternoon, I did email my presentation to Dr. DeShiro, and there's nothing confidential or pre-release about it. She can share it with anyone that wants to take a look. It's a good kind of step-by-step way to work it. The OOH is pretty intuitive, but it is a good step-by-step way to work yourself through it. But we'll talk in more detail later this afternoon. One of the few remaining hard copy publications produced by the BLS, as I said, is the Occupational Outlook Quarterly, the OOQ, which is especially useful for non-technical users such as media, politicians, no insults if you applied. Each quarter, the OOQ provides write-ups on various careers, and one issue each year focuses specifically on the projections data and presents that data as a series of charts. The projections data is pretty dense, so one of our four issues each year, and this was the most recent one, charting the projections as it's called, presents the projections as charts. Our most recent issue, which wasn't a projections-related one, looked at careers in sports. We try to do things that people might be interested in. Links to both the OH and the OOQ can be found at the BLS Employment Projections website, which I listed here. I gave you the direct link to the publication, but it all comes from bls.gov/imp. Also available on the Employment Projections website are various publications. The program's biennial news release. It's produced every other year, so that they said the 2012 and 2022 release will be the next one coming out. The most recent one is the 2010-2020. You also find data tables displaying the various projections data and research papers authored by BLS staff economists. Finally, although the BLS projections are only for the nation as a whole, each state government makes projections for their state, and some make projections even for local areas. The projections data is available at projectionscentral.com, and this is what that paper looked like if you got there. It's linked from our employment projections page. One thing to note, because our national projections are an input into their state projections, it often lags a little bit behind. So while we have 2010 to 2020 stuff out, you can see this is a screenshot I got from them yesterday. Their stuff is through 2018, so they were still working off our 08 to 18 stuff. I would wager that their 10 to 20 stuff should be out relatively shortly, because our 10 to 20 stuff has been out for a bit now. Here's my contact information. That's my direct line, direct email address. And as I said, I work in the public information office. That's a phone number that would ring myself and all my coworkers. BLS.gov is the Bureau's homepage. /RO1 is Regional Office 1. That's us in the Boston office. And we are tasked with staying abreast of regional economic trends, which we're going to talk about in the afternoon presentation, and assisting local data users. So if you ever have a question, whether it's about career prospects or, you know, research you're working on or homework you need help with, anything, give us a call. That's our job. We are there to pick up the phone. So don't hesitate, because you'll get a person. There's four of us, and there's always at least two of us there, so you will get a lot of person, which is rare these days. At this point, we have 10, 15 minutes. If we have any questions, I'd be glad to go back and ask the slides. If you want to look at one again, or if you have any questions about the data, feel free to let me know. Sure.
How does carbon trading and that whole sub-industry fit into the agreement data collection and classification?
So that would be potentially a green technology in practice, but I think there's no such output at this point. And that's done among industries. It's really difficult for us to collect, because it's the enforcement is kind of hodgepodge all over the place. And then, you know, you can sell your credits, or if you don't, you know, you can buy other people's credits if you want to pollute more. That's something that we've had a tough time collecting at this point. So how does it fit in? At this point, not very well. I can guide you to staff economists that work on the Green Jobs program. They've dealt with this stuff. They've been in the nitty-gritty of it all. I can give you their kind of information there at the program. All the program and methodological decisions all come down from DC, and we just get told what to do, and we follow orders. They're the ones making those, you know, high pay grade calls. I can guide you down to people down there that would be glad to talk to you more about that. That's one of the more difficult things, and we anticipate, you know, if there was some consistency in the implementation and regulation of it, it would make it easier. We depend on consistency. I mean, we've been collecting the unemployment rate the same way for 85 years. We need for data to be comparable, and the lack of consistency there just makes it very difficult, unfortunately. And again, the other thing is we have to avoid anything that might seem like a judgment call or a favorability call and things like that. So, but I'd be glad to put you in touch with probe people down in the national office, and they can tell you if they're planning on trying to make a better effort to capture those efforts or those data elements or not as well. Sure.
I have a question about the proxy you use for counting green jobs.
Yeah.
Give the example of the auto manufacturer using a pickup truck and hybrid vehicles.
Mm-hmm.
And if 70% of their revenue comes from the hybrid vehicle, you're assuming 70% of their workers use that vehicle. Now, I know if I submitted something like that to Dr. Teixeira, she might not accept that. It is a pretty...
It's a proxy, sure. And I mean, you know, I had a daily customer call a couple weeks ago, and he said, how do you calculate the unemployment rate? I said, it's a household survey. He said, how big is the sample? I said, 60,000 people. He said, you're gonna tell me you can predict what's going on, project what's going on in the whole country based on a household sample of 60,000 people? I said, yeah, it's a pretty good sample size. He said, well, I don't think you can do it unless you're asking everybody. He said, sir, this is a monthly survey. We're gonna collect it from 300 million people on a monthly basis. He said, well, why not? I can think of a lot of good reasons why not. I've been paid for professionalism and not even for that. Yeah, it's an imperfect measure, sure. And that's what we rely on, is transparency. We're not gonna, you know, lie to you. We're not gonna tell you. It's imperfect. The thing is, it's collectible. And we collect wage information in wage categories. The other thing we do is we average those wage categories. Because getting detailed wage information from an HR person in a company might be difficult. You got 100 employees. What does each person make? To the penny? They might not know that. If we give them, you know, $10 ranges, they can more accurately, more quickly fill it out.
So what's the sample size used for these firms?
The sample size for the Green Goods and Services Survey was 120,000 establishments. It's a pretty big sample. And again, yeah, share of revenue is a proxy. We're not the only ones doing it. And we didn't really, you know, we didn't make up the methodology. We piggybacked off of what others were doing. And it wasn't just we said, oh, well, Stats Canada tried it. It didn't work for them, so we'll just do what Stats Canada is doing. Even though it didn't work for them, we went out and tried it ourselves, and it didn't work for us either. So it's not like we didn't try and we gave up because they gave up. We tried on our own, and it just wasn't collectible. So it's a proxy. But we're telling you it's a proxy, so you got to give us credit for that. Sure.
You had some projections for the percentage growth in certain employment categories.
Yeah.
And per year is 2-3% or something like that. Average over the next 10 years, two, so yeah.
Yeah, annual rate of change.
But then you said the total number of jobs added was a certain number, I don't know, 10,000
right.
Or something like that. Is that over the 10 years, or is that average per year? The number
that
of jobs?
That's for the total growth spend, yeah. That's for the total. So we have, you know, that was from 10 to 20. So now I'm talking to you all about this data, you know, a little bit after it's been produced. So maybe of that 711,000, you know, 50,000 might already be in the economy, and there's now. We don't project how they're going to be spread out. This is just a... And we look at all kinds of things. I mean, these are their projections. So we look at demographic changes, you know, structural changes, and all the implementation, all the elements that we implement into our projections methodology is available at that vlas.gov/EMP, which tells you what factors we look into when we're making these projections data.
This may be for this afternoon, but just looking quickly at the projections here, it seems that most of the fastest growing job classifications don't require a college degree. I just wonder if you had information about that.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of it is certifications. In terms of numbers, yeah, just because, I mean, that's just a statement of the structure of the economy, especially where it's going to be because of demographic changes. That's certainly true. We can talk about that more in the afternoon session as well. But that is true. A lot of the professions that require college degrees are just smaller professions by nature. There's a lot more registered nurses than there are economists. So if there's only, you know, 8,000 economists in the country, we're not going to add 711,000 in the next 10 years.
Well, I guess if you're looking at percent growth, though, the growth in sectors or in occupations that do require a college degree.
Right. You're right. Even a lot of those aren't.
They're not showing up.
And you hear that discussion on the news a lot lately that, you know, is, and this is, I'm not speaking as an official of the Bureau at this point, the whole, is college worth it? You know, should we be sending kids to vocational schools or training programs or things like that? And it's certainly, you know, a discussion that's worth having given structural changes in the economy. And, you know, there's those professional students that just keep getting degree after degree after degree, and, you know, is there value in that? So, but we can talk about more in this afternoon as well.
But Mark, we're only looking at 10 occupations out of 100, right? So
out of, this is just the top 10. Again, we had 10 minutes. Yeah, I can guide you to the website where you can see all of it, and you can find your, that OOH, the Occupational Outlook Employment Handbook, Outlook Handbook, is really our best data product, because the nice thing about that is it's every occupation, and it tells you what you need to do to be that person, what you might make, and also the projected growth. So that's really our best data product. This was just a quick snapshot of, these are the highs and lows. Yeah, I mean, we didn't need to spend 5 minutes talking about the Postal Service, but it's an interesting fact. This is very top level stuff. Sure.
Is it possible to email you and get the actual PowerPoint for dissemination to other classes or possibly for other career counselors?
Yes. Yep. As long as it just needs to always be cited as BLS, but it's covered by right there. So we just ask that you not change it and, you know, make it out to be something it's not. But as long as it's cited as BLS data, you can, nothing's pre-released, nothing's confidential. You can do whatever you'd like with it. I'd be glad to. As I said, Dr. Shiro has hard copies, but I can give you an electronic copy.
Yes.
I'll give you my business card, and you can shoot me an email.
going back to the Green what's the survey response rate on those two?
They were pretty good. GDS was around, I want to say, 75%. That's a tough job, our field economists that are responding, because almost none of these are mandatory. A couple states have, none of these are mandatory. Some of our surveys are mandatory at some of the state level, but very few of our surveys are. So these are my coworkers that are going out to the field, bucking establishments, saying, you know, can I have an hour of your time? And I've done that. I've tagged along with them a couple times. And it's almost like a sales job. You got to really kind of get your way in the door, talk to the person. And we're not asking for anything confidential, and, you know, this is never going to come back. For tax purposes, you have to make people feel comfortable. There's a sort of an inherent fear of the government coming into your door and asking questions about your business. But they do a really good job, and our survey response rate, as I said, I think it was right around 75%. I know that the OES survey, which is, I said, that's where I used to work, and they're the ones conducting that occupational employment and wage aspect of the green, the GGS and the DTP, their survey response rates are always in the high 70s. So
high 70s both for the GGS and the GGS?
Yeah, I can give you the exact numbers, but that's pretty close, yeah.
And in terms of the GDP, what does who makes up, or which industry or sector makes up the top category in terms of who's using these new technologies?
We have it by industry.
Yeah.
We have it by employment. I don't know, is this computer hooked up to the web?
Yes, sure. Please.
We have this by so if you're on our website, this is where our press releases get published, right in the middle here. This is how you get to our regional offices. So if you'd be concerned with New England, you could click on New England, and that would take you to the webpage for my information office. But this is the best way to find what you're looking for by subject areas, and we're going to discuss these subject areas at the afternoon presentation. But under employment, you'll find green goods and services and green technologies and practices. And we can look at their tables. Establishments by industry, and then we have employment by industry. So we have construction right here, 134,000, which was 2.3% of total industry employment, 15.7% of GTP employment. Administrative and waste services is a big one. 17% of GTP employment, 2% of industry employment was, so that's saying that 2% of people in administrative and waste services are using one of those six green technologies and practices. So that gives you an idea of where they are. You know, finance and insurance, information in these, you know, office-related positions, they're very relatively few. A lot of those might be related to, you know, like telework arrangements, carpooling, things of that nature. You know, if your office has a designated transportation official that's in charge of organizing office carpools and things like that, which some larger companies do these days, you might see that type of thing.
Can you tell from the data how much of this is being done voluntarily by the company, or how much of it is part of, okay, so I have to follow such and such?
Oh, no, we don't get into motivations for why they're doing this. One thing we ran into, and it's kind of obvious, is that when the government comes knocking at your door and asks, are you doing things in a green way? There's an inherent bias. Say, oh yeah, sure we are. Like, you know, we had this in my program, Occupational Employment Statistics, we had what's called a management bias. We're reporting occupational employment wages for all occupations. So we ask what you do, we need to know your job title, and we'll try and, if it's not one of those ones that's in the SOC, in the Standard Occupational Classification System, if you tell us what you do, if you call yourself a secretary, well, we know you're in the SOC, that's an administrative assistant. But we found that everyone's calling themselves a manager. Well, I'm a manager at my desk, so I'm an administrative assistant manager. So we had to, and everyone wants to upcode themselves to be a manager. So we, not everybody, you know, 90% of people can't be managers. So managers, we had to come up with a definition. So what is a manager? They have people, they have lower level people reporting it to them, things of that nature. So the same thing with green. It was an inherent bias to say, oh yeah, sure, we're green. So that's why we had to be very specific with our questions and with that 50% threshold. But you know, we don't get into, some states might require it where other states don't, but we don't get into why they're doing it now.
Are these other questions available?
I don't know if the exact survey GTP So you, from any of our, so if you were to choose any subject area, on this left-hand navigation menu, the two most informative things you would find, they all have a contact tab, so you can contact the Green Technologies and Practices Program, and they also have an FAQ. So the FAQs are great for answering frequently asked questions. If it's not in the FAQ, you can always pick up the phone and call someone down to the program office. As I said, these are the people in Washington making the methodological decisions and developing the survey. That's what I did in OES, I would develop the survey. It's not confidential, and I mean, there's a chance that on a staff, if you have a job besides being a student, there's a chance that your establishment could get it, so you might have seen it. So they would probably be willing to give you a good idea of what the questions were, yeah. But it's basically, we call you up, we say, for the GTP at least, we say, you know, will you list you those six categories? Do you have anybody doing those categories? Yes or no? If you do, are they spending more than half their time doing it? Yes or no? And if it's yes to both of those, then we want to know what that person's job is and what they make. So it's pretty simple. I mean, if you wanted to know the specific, narration of the phone call that would occur, they would probably be willing to tell you what it is. But it's basically that. It's, do you do these six things? If so, is it more than half? And if so,
on behalf of Economics and Finance Department and School of Management and also Bureau of Labor Statistics, I would like to thank you for coming to the workshop. This is a general session, so I hope you can learn something new. And I just want to introduce today's presenter, Mark Maggi from BLS.
Thanks for that, and thanks for having me here this afternoon. My name is Mark Maggi. I'm an economist for the Bureau of Labor Statistics out of the Boston Regional Office. The unit I work in is called Economic Analysis Information. We sort of function as a PR of the BLS. We're tasked with writing regional press releases, conducting regional economic analysis, delivering presentations like this, which is how I find myself standing before you today. First, I want to thank you, and specifically Dr. Shiro, for providing me with the opportunity to speak today. This is part of our mission at the Bureau, educating people on our data. You're probably familiar with some of our data, hopefully further educate you on it. So once again, thanks for giving me this opportunity. Before we get started, because this is a general session, Dr. Shiro just asked me to give you some background information on my career at the Bureau, my history here. I apologize for repeating my autobiography twice to those of you who have read the last session. I've been at St. Mary's College, Maryland from 2001 to 2005. I began my academic career as a political science major. As a poli sci major at a liberal arts college, we had to take 101 econ and macro and micro. Took those three courses and developed interest in economics. I had some room in my schedule, so picked up econ as a second major. Graduated from school in 2005. Spring of my senior year, I didn't really have much of an idea of what I wanted to do. I thought about a career in politics, thought about going back to school, thought about looking through our family tree and seeing if I had any rich relatives I was unaware of that might support me in living a life of leisure. None of those things were in my future. Thankfully, spring of my senior year, there's a career fair on campus. There's someone from the BLS there. As an econ student, I was pretty familiar with BLS data, employment, inflation, stuff like that. But I had no idea who worked at the Bureau and what people did and what qualifications needed to have. Talking to that gentleman, I found out with 21 semester hours of economics coursework, anyone could be eligible for the position of economist at the BLS. Our two main jobs are economist and statistician. Economists far outnumber statisticians. They're the number crunchers. We're the people that come talk to you guys and write about stuff. So I applied for a job and started a job at the BLS in August of 2005, working for the Occupational Employment Statistics Program. OES produces occupational employment wage data by occupation and area. So we could tell you what a construction engineer makes in Warwick, Rhode Island versus what a construction engineer makes in San Diego, California. So it's pretty interesting data. People like to find out what they make and what they can make in the market. So I enjoyed my time down there. Spring of 2009, my fiance at the time got a job transfer up to Franklin, Mass. So we moved up to Newton, and I transferred to the Boston Regional Office. And I began working in Boston, as I said, in the Economic Analysis Information Unit, EANI, as it's called. And once more, we're sort of tasked with being the jack of all trades, master of none. We know a little bit about all the BR data products. I'm not a methodological expert or a data guy in any one specific program, but I have a good general understanding of everything that the Bureau produces, and my job is to pick up the phone or email and assist regional data customers, whether they're students doing research, a reporter from the Boston Globe writing a story, things of that nature. Someone, we get a lot of people using it for wage negotiations, or using the consumer price index for salary escalation or child support payment, things like that. So we're sort of the public arm of the bureau, and that's why I'm here today. So thanks. So moving from that fun story to some actual BLS data, we're going to first talk about the data programs available from the bureau. You're probably familiar with some of these numbers. You just don't know that they come from the BLS. All the quota is coming from the Labor Department. We are within the Department of Labor, but the BLS that's producing these things. So we'll touch on inflation and prices, pay and benefits, spending and time use, workplace injuries and fatalities, which comes from the BLS, productivity data. We do a little bit of international work, unemployment data and employment data, two of our more popular programs. I'll give you a quick overview of just the geographic structure of the Bureau. And then we're going to talk in more detail about our employment projections, the Occupational Outlook Handbook, which is a great resource for job seekers, whether they're students or mid-career job changers or career counselors. It's all available online now, as opposed to it used to be a big hard copy reference material. It's pretty intuitive, and I will say for the government website, it's pretty flashy and it works pretty well. So I'll give you a kind of walkthrough on that. And then we'll briefly touch on some New England economic trends. So let's start by talking about the Bureau's Inflation and Prices Program. This data is probably you're familiar with. You just might not know it comes from the BLS. The Consumer Price Index, or the CPI, produces monthly data on changes to prices paid by urban consumers for a representative market basket of goods and services. This is what you hear reported on the news as the inflation number. Each month, economists go out to the field and price items comprising a representative basket of goods and services. These include everything from food to clothing, gasoline, items you purchase in your everyday living experience. The change in the price of that basket of goods is calculated from month to month, and that's what's reported as the inflation number. The data is available for the nation, for census regions, and in this area, we do have a number for the Boston metropolitan area, which extends pretty far outside of Boston. The Boston data is released every other month. That's just because it's a much smaller sample size, so in order to have statistically valid, it's got to be a two-month sample. But we do have some local inflation data if you're interested in. CPI data is most commonly used for contract lease escalations. It's used as a way to estimate changes in cost of living. You'll hear the term COLA, talked about the cost of living adjustment. The CPI isn't entirely, it's not synonymous with a COLA because it misses some things like taxes and things like that, but it's used as a way to approximate a COLA. The Social Security Administration takes our third quarter CPI data, and that's how Social Security payments are adjusted. So from the late summer to early fall, our phones are ringing off the hook with your grandparents calling us wanting to know how much their Social Security payment's gonna go up by. The producer price index, I'm sorry, it's like the CPI, but that's from the perspective of a domestic producer. The PPI measures the average change over time in selling prices received by these producers for their output. So the PPI captured price movements prior to the retail level, and what this is good for is it can foreshadow subsequent price changes for businesses and consumers, because they're going to generally pass those price changes on down. Moving on, the Bureau also produces a great deal of data on pay and benefits. This data is used by HR professionals, contract and salary negotiators, and is used as an input into annual adjustments in Medicare payments to service providers. So a lot of other federal agencies use our data. Two different figures are produced by the National Compensation Survey. NCS is sort of is the program office, and then they have two surveys that are conducted by NCS. The first is the Employment Cost Index, or the ECI, similar to the Consumer Price Index. This isn't in dollar amounts, but tracks the changes in cost through the use of index points. So the BLS tracks the change over time in wages and salaries, benefits, and total compensation being the combination of wages and salaries plus benefits. We track the change of time over this number. This data is available by census region and division and by industry. So you can see our compensation costs increasing or decreasing in certain areas, in certain industries, things of that nature. And a lot of benefits managers, as I said, HR professionals find this data useful. But it's also interesting if you're looking at a certain field and you can go back and look at historic data, what's been the trend in compensation in this industry. We can't tell you, it won't be a dollar amount, but you can see it's gone up at 3%, it's gone down at 2%, things of that nature. Additionally, the NCS program produces the employer cost for employee compensation, the ECEC, as it's listed there. This figure is in dollar amounts and tracks compensation costs as paid by the employer. Both total compensation and its components are calculated. So you can see, for example, that it costs an employer in the manufacturing industry $30 an hour to employ one of the employees. What's in that $30 an hour? $20 might be wages and salaries, $6 might be leave and paid vacation and sick benefits, $2 might be health insurance, Finally, the Bureau of Occupational Employment Statistics Program, where I started my career, as I said, produces wage data by area and occupation. People like this because it's very relatable. It's dollars. We have the standard occupational classification system called the SOC. That's what we use to classify occupations. That's what all labor market groups generally use for occupational classification purposes. There's about 802 detailed occupations in the SOC, so chances are whatever you do, it's in there. OES tracks wages paid to those people the national level, at the state level, and at the MSA level. So it gets to a great deal of detail, telling you what people in specific occupations make in specific areas, you can compare with other areas or with the nation as a whole. The Consumer Expenditure Survey, moving on, I had actually bumped into Dr. DeShiro at a conference in Boston back in March, talking about Consumer Expenditure Survey data, program data. This provides information on the buying habits of American consumers, including data on their expenditures, income, and consumer unit characteristics. A consumer unit is a household, so that can be a family or just a single individual, they're living alone. The most recent consumer expenditure data just came out yesterday, actually. This data is actually collected on our behalf by the Census Bureau, and then we publish it. They are at people's houses more often than we are, so they can get this great deal of data. This is important because it's the only federal survey to provide information on the complete range of consumers' expenditures and incomes, as well as the characteristics of those consumers. It's used by policymakers examining the impact of policy changes on economic groups, by businesses and academic researchers studying consumer spending habits and trends, by other federal agencies, and perhaps most importantly, to revise the consumer price index market basket of goods and services and their relative importance. The only way the CPI reflects price changes in real life is if we're measuring things you actually buy. So the Consumer Expenditure Survey tracks what people are buying, and we look at what people are buying, we look at what's currently in that market basket of goods for the CPI, and make sure those two things align. People are buying a lot less typewriters these days, so typewriters might have fallen out of that market basket of goods, but iPads might be in the basket of this at this point. The American Time Use Survey, also sponsored by the BLS and collected by the Census, measures the amount of time people spend doing various activities such as working, caring for family, volunteering, socializing. It's exactly what it sounds like. It tracks what Americans spend their time doing. Researchers, journalists, educators, sociologists for sure, economists, lawmakers, lawyers, individuals, all use time use information. The survey produces nationally representative estimates of the US population's time by labor force status. We do have some demographic status, so you can see how people in different demographic groups spend their time, and other factors. Analysts are able to compare American time use data with similar data from almost 50 other countries that either do have or currently are planning to implement time use surveys. Moving on. The Injuries, Illnesses, and Fatalities Program provides annual information on the rate and number of work-related injuries, illnesses, and fatalities, and how these statistics vary by incident, incident being what caused the injury or fatality, is it a transportation accident, were you exposed to chemicals, was it a homicide, things of that nature, industry, geography, occupation, and other characteristics. This program publishes three releases each year, kind of listed here. The big one, the Census of Fatal Occupational Injuries, or CFOI, as it's known, is a count of the number of on-the-job fatalities in a given year. A preliminary count of the number of on-the-job fatalities for the previous year is released in the late summer or early fall of the following year, with the final data being available the following spring. So preliminary 2011 CFOI data was released last Thursday, and the final data will be released next spring. Changes are generally pretty minimal, but as more data becomes available and more fatalities can be verified as having happened on the job, they will get included. This data is all collected. This is a census. As the name implies, it's a census. So to the best of our ability, this is every on-the-job fatality that happens. Big events like the Gulf oil spill, over 12 people died in the collapse of that rig. Coal mine disasters, you'll generally see those things bring these counts way up in specific industries. And we do our best to capture every on-the-job fatality that happens in the nation. That's why it takes a little bit longer. We have surveys, which require a sample, and we have censuses, which means we're collecting everything. Censuses take a little bit longer, but they're much more comprehensive, and because they're a census, we have a lot more detail, demographic data, occupation data, industry data, things of that nature. The other two releases produced by the IIF program are the Survey of Occupational Injuries and Illnesses, or SOI, as it's called, S-O-I-I, which is published in the fall of the following year, following the reference year. So 2011 data are scheduled to be released next month, so it takes us almost a year to get the data out. We have to wait for the year to finish, obviously. Shortly after the release of the SOI publication, another publication comes out titled Non-Fatal Occupational Injuries and Illnesses Require Days Away from Work. This data is a subset of that occupational injuries and illnesses release. This subset is only those that require days away from work. Sometimes people are injured but stay on the job. It wasn't major enough to require days away from work. Maybe they stay on the job in a different capacity. So this second data, the number in this release will always be smaller in that release. Because it's a smaller number and we take a little bit more time with it, we get a little bit more demographic detail for these injuries. Another Bureau of Data product you might hear me mentioned on the news that you might not know is a Bureau of Data product is productivity data. Productivity and related cost measures are designed for use in economic analysis and public and private policy planning. The data are used to forecast and analyze changes in prices, wages, and technology. There are two primary types of productivity statistics. Labor productivity measures output per hour of labor, and the first one you see there. And multi-factor productivity takes into account things besides labor. Combined inputs, which consist of not just labor, but capital, and in some cases, intermediate inputs such as fuel. Coming out of the recession, we saw increases in productivity. Firms were producing more goods and services before they started hiring on new people. So more output, same number of people, equals an increase in productivity. So that was one of the early signs that we might have been getting out of the recession is when productivity started coming up, because that meant that although it wasn't a good sign that people weren't hiring, it was a good sign that outputs were increasing, because productivity can only go up so much before they finally say, you know, people are being overextended, we need to bring on new people. So this can be a bit of a leading economic indicator. One common question we get is, does the Bureau produce any international data? A little bit would be the answer. The International Price Program, the BLS, contains data on changes in the prices of non-military goods and services traded between the United States and the rest of the world. Also, the International Labor Comparisons, ILC program, adjusts data to a common conceptual framework because direct comparisons of national statistics across countries can be misleading due to different concepts and methodologies. We don't all collect data the same way, unfortunately. ILC data are used to assess U.S. economic and labor market performance relative to that of other countries and to evaluate the competitive position of the U.S. in increasing global markets. This stuff is becoming more and more important as the world gets smaller and trade happens faster and faster. Data are published by country or by indicator. Indicators include labor market, hourly compensation costs, productivity, GDP per capita and per hour, as well as consumer prices. Something you're probably all familiar with. Unemployment data. The current population survey, CPS, is a monthly survey of households conducted by the Bureau of Census, once again, for the BLS. It's a 60,000 household survey sample. And this is where the national unemployment rate comes from. It provides a comprehensive body of data on the labor force, employment, unemployment, persons not in the labor force, hours of work, earnings, and other demographic and labor force characteristics. Because this is a household survey, we have a lot of detail about the people in this survey. We have a tremendous amount of demographic detail. On a monthly basis, we'll produce the unemployment rate, the labor force. The labor force is the total of the employed plus the unemployed. Unemployed are people who aren't working but have conducted job-seeking activity in the past month. My parents are both retired, so they don't have jobs, but they're not looking for work, so we don't count them as unemployed. So the unemployed are people who, as I said, want to be working, have conducted job-seeking activity, but aren't currently working. So the employed plus the unemployed equals the labor force. When you hear people talking about the labor force, that's what we're talking about. Not in the labor force are children, elderly, or people who might have given up looking for work, things of that nature. But as I said, we do have a great deal of demographic data on this. The unemployment rate, most of the metrics come out on a monthly basis. That real detailed demographic stuff does come out on an annual basis, just because we need a little bit more data for it to be statistically valid. But the CPS program, if you're at all interested in demographic stuff, that's where you would go. The website would just be bls.gov/CPS, and you find a lot of great demographic detail. The local area unemployment statistics, LAUS as it's called, produces monthly and annual employment, unemployment, and labor force data for census regions and divisions, states, counties, metropolitan areas, and many cities by place of residence. So this is sort of the local component of the CPS. CPS is everything national, top line. LAUS is similar data, but at the local level. The Boston Regional Office produces a monthly unemployment rate release on the 6 New England states and the New England region as a whole. We produce a release twice a year, looking at unemployment on Cape Cod and the islands. That's going to go out tomorrow. So we have a lot of neat, real local area specific stuff that we can take a look at. And if we don't produce a press release on it, doesn't mean we don't have it. We just can't run a press release on every piece of data we have. unemployment. The mass layoff statistics program collects data, reports on mass layoff actions that result in workers being separated from their jobs. Monthly mass layoffs are numbers are from establishments of at least 50 initial claims from the unemployment insurance UI program against them during a 5-week period. So this would be, factory shutting down would be an example of one. Sometimes contract money runs out, but they know it's coming back. So that could be a short-term mass layoff. If for any reason production gets slowed, you often see car companies, if there's a surplus of a certain model on a dealer's lots, they might shut down production in the factory for a period of time to let inventory catch up with demand. We also then have extended mass layoffs. This number is issued quarterly, so the mass layoffs is monthly. Extended mass layoffs is quarterly. Extended mass layoffs is a subset of those mass layoffs. This is from private sector non-farm employees, employers, where 50 or more workers were separated from their jobs for 31 days or longer. So a mass layoff might have been a short-term thing, a problem at a factory, contract money that dried up and the company was renewed for a week for legal reasons, car factory shutting down for a couple weeks while inventory catches up with demand. Extended mass layoffs generally imply something more structural, factory closing down, things of that nature. From unemployment to employment, each month the current employment statistics, CES program, as you can tell, the Bureau loves acronyms, surveys about 141,000 businesses and government agencies, representing approximately 486,000 individual work sites, in order to provide detailed industry data on employment, hours, and earnings of workers on non-farm payrolls. This is a count of the number of jobs in the economy. The number of jobs can be higher than the number of employed, because people can have more than one job. So the CPS will give you a number of the employed, the unemployed, combine those two to get the labor force. CES will give you a number of jobs in the economy, which, as I said, can be higher than the number of employed because people can have more than one job. Similar to how Laos was the local component of CPS, SAE, state and area employment, is the local component of CES. The state and area employment program is part of the CES and produces data for all 50 states, the District of Columbia, Puerto Rico, the Virgin Islands, and about 400 metropolitan areas and divisions. One more, under county employment here, we have the Quarterly Census of Employment Wages, or QCEW. This program publishes a quarterly count of employment wages reported by employers covering 98% of U.S. jobs. And again, you can see the word census in here, so it's a comprehensive count. This data is available at the county, MSA, state, and national levels by industry. So while the CES data is available on a monthly basis and released in the month immediately following the reference month, so we're in September now, so August data is out, the quarterly census of employment wages is quarterly, as the name implies, and it takes about 6 months for the data to come out because it is a census, so it's a much larger body of data. So fourth quarter data was released in June. So it's a little bit more lag for our census-based program versus our survey-based programs. The QCW program does produce one really interesting statistic that a lot of researchers use, and that is data by establishment size. We have establishment size categories. I think it's under 10, 10 to 20, 20 to 50, 50 to 100, 100 to 90, 199. And you can look at whether staffing patterns, hours worked, wages differ by establishment size. Sometimes you see smaller establishments with more hours worked because there's less people doing the work. A couple more employment programs we have. The Job Openings and Labor Turnover Survey, or JOLTS. JOLTS produces program data on job openings, hires, and separations. JOLTS produces data by industry and by census region, so the Northeast would be our region up here. The job openings number you hear quoted in the news sometimes, that comes from JOLTS, which stated that there was 200,000 job openings in the economy last month. As I mentioned, the JOLTS also tracks the inverse of openings, which are separations. One type of separation is a quit. An increase in the number of quits is often seen as a good sign for the labor market, because people generally don't quit their job unless they feel there's better opportunities elsewhere. So sometimes if we see the number of quits going up, that could actually be a good thing, even though it doesn't sound like it. The BLS has also just begun producing data on green jobs, which some of you saw earlier today. We have two surveys that produce data on this topic, and I'll just touch on them very briefly, so not to bore this morning's audience. First is the GGS, or the Green Business Services Survey. The GGS program is a survey-based program covering 120,000 business establishments, which provides a measure of national and state employment in industries that produce goods or services that benefit the environment. The other survey is the Green Technology and Practices, or GTP survey. The GTP is a special survey for business establishments designed to collect data on establishments' use of green technologies and practices. and the occupations of workers who spend more than half their time involved in duties engaged in those green technologies and practices. So the GGS is concerned with the output. Does your establishment make a green good or service? Wind turbines, solar panels, things like that. The GTP, we don't care about what you're making, we care about how you're doing it. So a restaurant that grows its own vegetables and its herbs, that might be in the GTP, because they're producing a non-green output food services, but they're doing it in an environmentally friendly way. So we're trying to capture both sides of the coin there. Finally, employment projections data, the EP program. The employment projections program develops information about the labor market for the nation as a whole for 10 years into the future, and we're going to discuss that in more detail in a minute. We briefly touched on it this morning, but we'll go into some more detail today. Before we get there, I just want to provide you a quick breakdown of the geographic structure of the BLS. The national office where I started my career is located in Washington, D.C. Each of the various programs we discussed just now have their program headquarters based out of the national office. This is where survey and sample design, methodological decisions, generally all the strategic top-level planning happens. Additionally, this is where the majority of our statistical staff is based. The national office has a combination of both economists and statisticians. In comparison, the regional office, of which there are eight, our local one here would be New England, although we do work closely with the New York office. Their states are New York, New Jersey, Pennsylvania, and the regional offices are where field economists who engage in data collection are based out of. So many of my coworkers in Boston are the people going out to collect that price data for the CPI. Every month, they have to be very careful to make sure they're collecting the same data. So if they priced 100% cotton t-shirts last month, they have to make sure they're going back this month and pricing those same 100% cotton t-shirts, not 90% cotton t-shirts. Because the item's not the same, and there's a price change, but we don't know if it's due to inflation or due to a quality difference. We have people that call up establishments to get that pay, to get that benefits data, things of that nature. So a lot of our regional staff are collections folk. Each regional office has an economic analysis and information unit, which is where I work. And as I mentioned, we engage in outreach, offer press releases, conduct regional reports, and answer data questions from regional users, whether they be media, people in academia, researchers, you name it. All right, let's move on to the employment agenda. So we don't have a ton of time, so I'm going to give you a quick background on the EP data, a brief run through of some projected industry occupational growth, which will be repetitive for this morning's audience, but we're going to zip through it, so don't worry. And then I'm going to steer you in the right direction if you wish to dive deeper into this topic. So the BLS employment projections produce a new set of 10-year projections every 2 years. The most recent projections out are the 2010 to 2020 projections, 12 to 2022 projections will be the next round, released next year. They cover over 700 occupations in 300 industries, and they form the basis for data and outlook information in the Occupational Outlook Handbook. A new edition of the handbook was released shortly after each round of projections is published. The OOH has been published since 1949. As of this year, it's now online, and what we'll discuss in more detail once we get to this projection stuff is a step-by-step run-through of that online OOH. Who uses this data? A wide variety of people, career counselors and students looking to make career choices, mid-career job seekers looking to switch occupations, state educational program planners reviewing curriculum, and researchers interested in how the economy is changing. So what industry changes do we expect to see at this point, the next 8 years? It was 10 years, projection from the data came out, and that's we're looking out to 2020. Healthcare and social assistance, which is made up of private institutions, is the fastest growing industry, in addition to being the largest in terms of projected employment growth gains, 3% growth expected. Construction employment is projected to grow fast. Part of that, though, is due to losses coming out of the recession, where by 2020, it's doubtful that we'll hit our 2006 peak, but there are job gains expected to be made just because the trough was so deep in terms of coming out of the recession. Educational services, number three, made up of private educational institutions, is the third best growing sector in terms of employment. It's ranked ninth in terms of the absolute number of jobs added. State and local government down here at just under 1% includes public education, hospitals, things of that nature. And as I mentioned this morning, federal government is projected to decrease by a large amount. A couple reasons for this, pressure to reduce the budget deficit, and about half of this decrease is going to come from the Postal Service, which is going to face large contractions, mostly due to a lack of need for their services as things transition to the internet and also private competition. So what occupations are we projecting growth and employment decreases in? This slide shows the top 10 fastest growing detailed occupations This slide shows the 10 occupations expected to add the most jobs, going up to 2020 in terms of absolute number of jobs. Many of the occupations listed on the table are very large and will therefore create many new jobs, even though their growth rates might be lower. The expected growth in healthcare will drive demand for registered nurses, which are projected to add the most jobs, 712,000 almost, and home health aides, over 706,000. Both of these occupations were in the previous slide as well. Two office administrative support occupations appear on the list, general office clerks and customer service representatives, primarily because their occupations are employed in many industries. They both had more than 2 million jobs in 2010. As I touched on this morning, these are occupations that exist across all industries. If your occupation is just in one industry, and that industry is decreasing for structural changes or international competitive changes, things of that nature, your opportunities are limited elsewhere. These occupations, however, exist across all industries, so a shrinking in your specific industry that you work in doesn't mean you can't find work elsewhere as an administrative assistant. Seven of these occupations make less than the median annual wage for May of 2010, so the national median wage is about $34,000. Seven of these are below that median. Fastest declining occupations. Occupational employment declines generally stem from changes in technology, such as automation, business practices, or declines in industries in which the occupation is concentrated. If an occupation is concentrated in one specific industry, and that industry is declining, chances are that occupation is going to decline. The occupation projected to decline the fastest at 53.4% is shoe machine operators and tenders. However, this decline is only going to cause a loss of about 1,700 jobs over the 10-year period. It's a pretty small occupation. Five of these occupations are in textile, apparel, and furnishing worker industries. They're all concentrated in textile and apparel manufacturing industry. So that projected growth is all coming from increased pressure from imports. Four occupations are also among the 10 occupations with the largest employment decline. Two postal service related occupations, postal service mail sorters and postal service clerks, strong machine operators and switchboard operators, which many of you are probably surprised there are any of those at all at this point. Even in occupations where there's no new job growth projected, that doesn't mean there won't be openings, because people do retire and those retirements do need to be filled. So just because we're not projecting growth doesn't mean we're not projecting openings. So it's important to differentiate between the two of those. This slide shows the 10 retail occupations predicted to lose the most jobs from 2010 to 2020. So the previous slide was percentage decrease. This is absolute number decrease. Farmers, ranchers, and other agricultural managers will lose 96,100 jobs, more than any other occupations. These numbers are in thousands. Sorry, just point that out. And that's because technological improvements and consolidation continue to reduce the number of workers needed to produce the nation's food. You'll see three occupations related to the postal service. And again, you have those switchboard operators and those sewing machine operators on there. I just want to make you aware of some products available from the BLS Employment Projections Program. The BLS Employment Projections website is bls.gov/EMP. The one thing they produce, which we're going to discuss in detail, is the OOH. Excuse me. This is what it looked like. It's a hard copy publication. It's now available online, and it's pretty good, and we're going to discuss that in a lot of detail. The handbook includes not only job outlook information, but detailed job descriptions, education and training data, and earnings. If someone asked at lunch, it's also got a neat little search tool. Let's say you know what you want to do, it's pretty easy. You can look up that occupation, what might you make, what education and training are you required to have, what do your job prospects look like. So let's say you don't know that, but you do know what you hope to make, and you know what qualifications you have. You can say what occupations are going to make more than $40,000 a year, require this degree, and are going to grow at a certain percentage, and it'll give you back a return. So it's pretty neat that you don't even have to know what you're looking for, and it'll get you back to what might be applicable to you. One of the few remaining hard copy publications produced by the BLS, since we don't produce the OOH anymore in hard copy form, is the Occupational Outlook Quarterly. Non-technical users like this, it's written very, very casually. The most recent edition covered careers in sports. We're trying to do topics that might interest the general public, the media, things like that. One issue each year does look at our projection data, so that's what I put here. They'll say charting the projections, and projection data is pretty cumbersome, so what we do in the OOQ is we just use some charts to highlight it in a little bit more user-friendly like format. Links to both the OOH and the OOQ can be found at the BLS Employment Projections website, which I mentioned earlier, which is listed here. Also available on that website are any employment projections publications. They're biennial news release. I said the most recent one is 2010 to 2020. Data tables. You don't want to read the news release. A lot of the data is written in table format. There's also some charts and research papers conducted by staff and comments at the BLS also get posted there after publication. We do produce some state projections, or I should say some of our state partners produce state projections. BLS's projections are only done at the national level, but our state partners take our national data as an input into some state level projections. This data is available at projectionscentral.com. They do it for states as well as some local areas. One thing to note, our data, as I said, is an input to their data. So our data always comes out before their data. Their data lags a little bit behind. As of right now, their most recent projection is out through 2018, but ours are out through 2020, so they should catch up with us shortly. All right, so as I said, let's talk a little more detail about the Occupational Outlook Handbook, the OOH. The OOH is the nation's premier source of career information. And includes profiles for hundreds of occupations to describe what they do, their work environment, how to become one, and the pay in those occupations. So hopefully this will be of particular interest to all of you. These profiles include employment projections, so you can take a look at what the BLS predicts future prospects of that occupation to be. As I said, the OOH is the Bureau's most popular product. There was over 9 million page views in April of 2012, which is far and away the highest number of page views we had for any of our pages. It's used by job seekers and those that assist them, students, recent grads, mid-career job seekers, career changers, counselors, people assisting these people. Anyone familiar with the previous issue of the OOH is going to notice some changes. I'm speaking to one gentleman at lunch who was not too happy that it's no longer a hard copy publication. He liked the big encyclopedia, but I think he's in the minority there. The OOH has been redesigned for the web, and it's probably about time. And it's no longer going to be printed, as with many of our hard copy publications and hard copy publications everywhere. Moving to a web-based format makes sense from a printing and cost standpoint. Gives it a more intuitive user experience. And we're not perfect, so if we mess up, it's much easier to change the website than change the old one. The content does remain mostly the same, so everything you found in the OOH in the past is still there, just under different headers. And if that gentleman is in the audience right now, I can tell him what the new headers are. So if you're here, sir, what used to be called Training, Other Qualifications, and Advancement is now titled How to Become One, right there. The Nature of Work section is now titled What They Do. The information that was previously found in the employment section can now be found in the work environment and job outlook sections. And the projections data is now all in the job outlook section. We tried to make the titles a little bit clearer for an easier user experience. So what's new? I'm going to show you some screenshots of the OOH at the moment, but briefly, each occupational tab, so if you know what you want to do, it's going to have, I mean, each occupational page, you know what you want to do, have 8 tabs on it. There's also a new search handbook box. A good search tool is a great asset for any website. And this new feature makes the OOH a lot easier to use. Both the OOH search bar and the main search bar in the top right corner of BLS.gov is greatly improved. BLS economists used to go out to Google and use Google to find our own data, as our own embedded search bar was so bad, but they improved that. Now you can use our own search bar, and you guys should too. Pretty good. There's also a new occupation find, which we talked about earlier, which allows you to filter occupations by various detailed categories such as pay range, education level, training, projected number of new jobs, job growth rate. So even if you don't know what you want to do, if you know what you're looking for, we can guide you in the right direction. So for example, you can do a search of what occupations typically require a high school diploma, pay about $55,000 a year, and then projected to grow 29% more faster. The redesigned OOH has more detailed profiles than ever before, with 341 occupational profiles covering 536 detailed occupations. So chances are we can give you some information on the occupation you're considering. Users can now browse occupations with the highest pay, the best employment growth, and most predicted job gain creation. Those are 3 metrics that we know are pretty common, so we put those right up front. You can also find charts comparing the median pay and projected percent change in employment to a baseline of all occupations, and I'll bring up some of those charts earlier, or later. So here's a screenshot of what you'll find when you go to the new OOH online. homepage, you can find the top 20 occupations sorted by highest paying, fastest growing, and most new jobs. That's the three of our most popular metrics, so we put them out front. There's also an occupation finder, as well as an A to Z index. Here's a look at what you find for some of the fastest growing occupations, as we talked about earlier, personal care aides, home health aides, growth rate, and median pay. Here's a screenshot of the occupation finder I described. So it's a series of drop-down menus, and you can select the criteria you want in each menu, and as long as you aren't too specific, hopefully you'll get some results back. And here's the A to Z index. This is specifically part of the letter G. It's a really big index, so I just took one screenshot. So as I mentioned earlier, once you select a specific occupation, you're gonna have 8 tabs where you can find more detail on that occupation. This is really the meat of the OOH. The first of those 8 tabs is a summary tab, which includes quick facts, such as what they earn, education and training, employment, projected jobs, both percent and level change. So here you have that, and our running example we'll use for this presentation is music directors and composers. So the summary tab, we're on tab number 1 right there. You have your median pay, entry-level education required, it's the job outlook, predicted employment change, on-the-job training, and a brief description of what they do and their work environment. The next 2 tabs are labeled what they do, which describes in more detail the typical duties associated with that occupation, and work environment, which describes where they work, whether the job is dangerous, and what their job schedules are like. So if you select the what they do tab, and you're still on music directors and composers, it gives you a good explanation of the duties related to that occupation. And here's what you find under the work environment tab. A little bit of detail about their work environment, where they work, recording studios, concert halls, things of that nature, and their work schedules. 4th tab, labeled how to become one. This describes the education, work experience, on-the-job training, and licenses and certifications required, as well as details about important qualities and advancement opportunities. If you select how to become one, then this is what you would see. If you were looking for this online, you could do one of 2 ways. Up in the navigation bar, it would be vls.gov/OOH. You can also browse by subject areas, similar to how these are tabbed across here. These menus up here are tabs. Subject areas is the tab you most frequently want to use. If you drop that down, you would see the subject areas we briefly discussed earlier, inflation and prices, employment, unemployment, things of that nature. Under employment, you can be kind of in the middle here, you can see employment projections, and that's where you get the OOH. Or, as I said, you can always just use the search bar. The next tab, left to right, is the pay tab, which includes data on wages, as well as union membership, which is an interesting statistic that we track that people like to look at. So here's what a screenshot of selecting the pay tab would look like for our example of music directors and composers. It does give you this chart comparing the median annual wages in 2010 of music directors and composers to the occupational group from which that occupation comes. As I said on that first OOH slide, you had that occupational group listing here. So music directors and composers would have fallen in arts, design, entertainment, sports, and media occupations. So we compare it to the incomes, and we also compare it to the total all occupations number. That's a nationwide average. The 6th tab, job outlook, is what many people come to the OOH to find. This is what are my prospects. And this is where the employment projections kind of merges with the OOH. Here you're going to find how much of the occupation projected to grow or possibly contract during the projection period. An explanation for this change, job prospects, and a chart comparing projected change to aggregate and total, similar to the chart we just looked at for pay. So under job outlook, just a brief description. Again, we're almost over to the right here, and projected change in employment compared to the total, compared to the major group in which it came, and to the specific occupations you're looking at. Next, you'll find a tab that lists similar occupations, as well as their job duties, education requirements, and pay. So let's say you thought you knew what you wanted to do, you get there, and your dream of being a shoe machine operator, you find out that it's projected to contract 60% over the next 8 years. So you say, what can I do that would be like that, but might not be projected to decline so much? And the final tab on any occupational detail screen will provide you with contact details, should you want further information that the Bureau doesn't have. So under similar occupations to our music directors and composers, we have actors, dancers, and choreographers.
occupations, and it does give you the educational part for those as well if they ever need pay, if it's available. And then for more information on this profession, it's suggested that you contact the National Association of Schools and Music. So the BLS is an expert on every occupation in the economy, but we'll give you as much detail as we have and as we've collected, and then we'll guide you to the appropriate industry of your trade organization or things of that nature. All right, we've got a little bit of time left, and Dr. Bashiro asked if I could cover a brief overview of some of the economic trends in the New England region. And I want to leave plenty of time for questions because I know we're covering a lot of material here, so thanks for bearing with me. I thought I'd briefly touch on some unemployment rate data as well as some industry employment data. We'll take a look at how these metrics have changed from July of 2009 to July of 2012. The recent recession officially ended in June of 2009, so we're looking at a nice, neat three-year period. In June of 09, so in July of 09, to July of 2012. July of 2012 for a lot of our data programs is the most recent data we have. We're now at the end of September, so we do have some August data, but we didn't when I was making this presentation. And this year we're looking at 36 months and 37 months. So we're going to look at July of 09 to July of 2012. So let's compare the unemployment rate in the United States to that of the New England region. If you remember from earlier, the national unemployment rate data comes from the current population survey, and that regional, state, and local unemployment rate data comes from our LEPS, the Local Area Unemployment Statistics Program. Over the past 3 years, the unemployment rates of the New England region and the U.S. have tracked nearly parallel, with the regional rate consistently about 1 percentage point below the national rate. So what's happening in the 6 states that comprise the New England region? Here are the unemployment rates of the U.S. and Connecticut displayed together. As you can see, Connecticut's rate has tracked also pretty closely with the national rate, seeing recent decreases, although an uptick in the past couple months. Some months slightly higher, some months slightly lower, but for the most part, there's not been a statistically significant difference between the rates of Connecticut and nation in the past 3 years, and that statistical significance is an important thing because these are surveys, they're not censuses, so it's based on a sample. So all you econ and finance majors know about statistical significance. There's error ranges, and you know they have to be outside of each other's error ranges to be a statistically significant difference. Connecticut and the U.S., although there's a gap at times, that gap is within the margin of error, so we just say that it's essentially the same. That's our key word, is essentially. Here we have the unemployment rates for the United States and the state of Maine. Again, we have a 3-year period, and this is seasonally adjusted data. Seasonally adjusted data allows us to compare non-like months. Seasonal factors affect unemployment rate data. As I said, we write a press release on unemployment on Cape Cod and the islands. As you can expect, unemployment is much higher in the wintertime on Cape Cod and the islands than it is in the summertime. The inverse is also true. Ski towns see much lower unemployment in the winter than they do during the summer. So seasonal adjustment allows you to compare January to July. If you don't seasonally adjust, you can only compare July to July or January to January. The rates for Maine and the U.S. have tracked pretty closely to one another, and for most months, the difference is not this significant, especially as of late, being less than half a point. The error range for the states is a little bit larger than that of the U.S. The U.S. is a pretty statistically robust sample for our states, especially our smaller states, and then our med areas. The error range is a little bit larger, and that's just by virtue of a smaller sample size. So the unemployment rate for the United States and Massachusetts were relatively close for most of 2009, 10, and 11, but the past 6 months, the unemployment rate for Massachusetts has dropped nearly a full percentage point, whereas the U.S. rate has stayed relatively flat during that time period. As such, although it wasn't until about this point, the difference between the U.S. and the Massachusetts rates, as it stands now, is statistically significant. As you can see here, one of our better performing states, New Hampshire, has consistently been well below the nation, ranging around 5.5%. The unemployment rate in the state of New Hampshire has consistently been in the bottom 10 among all states nationally. Unfortunately, the inverse. Look at the second to soak in. In contrast, the unemployment rate in the state of Rhode Island has consistently been more than 2 percentage points higher than the national rate over the past 3 years. In fact, during this time period, Rhode Island has been in the bottom three or top three, depending on West half full, West half empty, joined by California and Nevada. I wish it wasn't true. We keep writing the same thing every month. Rhode Island's always among the top three. California and Nevada along with it. Going the other way, the unemployment rate of Vermont is the exact opposite of what we just Vermont has consistently been in the top five. Vermont is by far our best performing state in terms of its unemployment rate. All right, so let's take a look at what's been going on in each of the 6 million states at the industry level to try and figure out why this is true. What industries are the job gains and losses in that reflect the unemployment rate data that we just saw? This slide examines unemployment change by industry super sector, the United States in purple, and Connecticut in green, over the same time period we just looked at, July 09 to July 12. So this is a 3 month, three year percentage difference. We took the employment number for each of these industries, July 09, compared to the employment number July 12, and calculated the percentage difference. So it's two snapshots in time, calculating the percentage difference between them. In both Connecticut and the US, employment increased in education and health services, which shouldn't be too much of a surprise based on the projections data we talked about, as well as professional and business services, and leisure and hospitality. Education and health services actually exhibited job growth both during and after the recession. So you hear about some industries being recession-proof. People still generally need medical care, whether it's recession or not. They might not need vacations. Trade, transportation, and utilities saw modest increases both nationally and within the state. Right there. Across the remaining sectors, we're still seeing declines despite the official end of the recession. So even though the recession is over, we're still seeing job losses. Construction employment fell deeply during the recession and it has actually fallen further since. Each state in New England lost more jobs, and that's as a percentage, not absolute value, in the construction industry than in any of the 9 major industry sectors. Maine also saw employment growth in education and health services, professional and business services, and leisure and hospitality. Education and health services, leisure and hospitality. Although slower growth rates here than we saw in the state of Connecticut, both Maine and New Hampshire, as we're going to see later, saw steep job losses in the information sector. Other than Connecticut's drop of 9.2%, Maine's loss of 6.5% in the construction sector was the highest among all New England states. So Maine got hit really hard in the construction sector and is still losing jobs post-recession. Maine has the steepest job losses among all New England states in the manufacturing sector as well, down 3.7% over this 3 year period. So construction and manufacturing, despite the recession being over, are still losing jobs at a pretty steep rate in the state of Maine. In Massachusetts, again, looking over the last 3 years, you'll see job growth in education and health services sector, a little bit left. Employment rose in Massachusetts in this sector, both during and after the recessionary period as well. Driving this growth were gains within the healthcare and social assistance industries. Educational and health services also is Massachusetts' largest super sector behind employment, so it's seeing growth and it's our biggest constant number of jobs. Professional business services has shown steep recovery since incurring losses during the recession, up 10.4% since July 2009. Professional business services includes legal, architectural, accounting, computer system design, things of that nature. Information has grown 1.7% over the period compared to a decline of 4.8% nationally. This sector includes publishing industries, both print and digital and software. Across the remaining sectors, we see growth, save for declines in construction, financial activities, and governments. Massachusetts and Vermont would be only one of the states to see growth in the manufacturing sector during this period. Small growth, 0.1%, but not many states have had their manufacturing sector recover yet post-recession. Massachusetts and Vermont were our two local states that have. Here's New Hampshire, same time period. New Hampshire had employment growth in 4 industries, other services, leisure and hospitality, other services here, 10%, leisure and hospitality, trade, transportation, and utilities, and professional and business services. The growth in other services, you see that 10%, that's 100 times greater than the national job growth rate. This super sector is kind of a hodgepodge of exactly what it sounds like. Other services include things like automotive repair, personal care services like barbershops, beauty salons, things of that nature. New Hampshire had employment declines in 6 industries, most notably joining Maine, as we mentioned, with large large job losses within information, down 12.2% post-recession. This was more than twice as fast as the national rate of decline, almost three times as fast, actually. Back to some local detail. Why has Rhode Island's unemployment rate remained higher than the national average over the past 3 years? Notably, you'll see employment growth in just three super sectors. Professional and business services, 1.7% compared to the national average, 9.3%. Leisure and hospitality, tourism is up, and weather was good this summer, but it's a relatively small super sector, so even though job gains happened there, job gains in the small sector don't really have the same job losses in the larger sector. And information, again, small, 1.7%. Every other state in New England saw employment growth in at least four, if not more, super sectors. Rhode Island's got three overall. Small job growth rates and small industries at that. As I said, although there's employment increase in information, this is actually the smallest super sector in the state. So one of the three that had growth is your smallest super sector. So growth here doesn't really do much to offset losses in larger super sectors, you know, construction, manufacturing, things of that nature. Finally, this is Vermont. We find employment growth at 8 super sectors. So Rhode Island, 3. Vermont, 8. More than any other New England state. Vermont was the only state to see employment growth in construction, 3%, so a roughly significant growth rate the past 3 years. Additionally, Vermont joined Massachusetts as one of the only two states in New England to see growth in manufacturing. So two sectors that were hit very hard during the recession that haven't really recovered nationally, have recovered pretty well in Vermont. Manufacturing and construction, where a lot of losses were, and they're both up 2.33% respectively. Massachusetts, as it also grew in manufacturing, but you remember, was 0.1%, and they were down 5.1% in construction. So up 0.1% and down 5.1% compared to up 2.3% and up 3.0%. You can see Vermont is doing pretty well. All right, there's my contact information. That's my direct line and my email address. That's contact information for the New England Information Office where I work. That's our public information line, so if I'm not in, someone will just pick up that phone. That's our regional webpage. BLS.gov is BLS homepage, /RO1 for regional office for one. And that's a general information email on questions. So if you have a general BLS data question, you can always email me or you can send it to our office and someone's definitely going to get back to you probably in about 4 hours or so. Is there any questions before we all wrap up and go our separate ways? I know we covered a lot of material between BLS programs. Yes? Yes, I had briefly touched on that. Going back, sorry. There we go. The International Price Program, IPP it's called, they produce changes on prices of non-military goods and services traded between the U.S. and the rest of the world. And we also have our International Labor Comparisons Program, ILC it's called. You either search this or generally, the program's acronym, the website would just be bls.gov/its acronym, so OES would be bls.gov/OES, ILC would be bls.gov/ILC. What the ILC program does is they will try and make data comparable across common conceptual frameworks, so direct comparisons amongst different nations are more comparable, for lack of a better word. Yes? Any other questions? Check there. If not, there'll be contact OOH. And those are the people who were involved in the redesign. I know how to use it. You know, I think there is availability in Spanish. I don't know anything beyond that. And I think the Spanish version...
Beyond Google Translate, you know.
Yes, yes, I think, I believe the Spanish version, and again, you have, this is, I don't use the OH that much. I'm not tasked with that program area. I believe there is availability in Spanish. Oh yeah, there you go, en español right there. Sorry, it's missing that. Beyond that, Google Translator. Sorry. Limited resources. Any other questions?
Data's out there, we do our best to educate people.